You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome to the Individual and Society, Sociology 101. My name is Sergio Soto, and welcome to our live lecture. Today's topic will cover government, social movements, and basically our understanding of it and how it influences our lives. Now, before we get started with our first discussion on power and authority, always remember that you can call in, you can write in, and participate in this live discussion. You can call in at 800-339-1193, or you can write in at askdhtv@gmail.com. You don't necessarily have to be enrolled in this course. It's open to the community. We all live in society. Today's topic, we all deal with government, it influences our lives. So, it's something we can all comment on. On a side note, there's also two more broadcasts left. The last class is December 9th, right? So you can mark that on your calendars. That doesn't necessarily mean the class ends at that time for those of you who are taking it, but do keep in mind the due dates on Blackboard. But again, today we'll discuss government. Now, with everything that we've been kind of considering, thinking about since we begin this class, we've been talking about how our identities are shaped, this process of socialization, and what it means to be a member of society. Now, when we think about this, how we govern or how societies are governed, culture is important, but the state, whether it's, and then when we talk about the state, it's what we mostly assume as government. It can be the nation state, right? The state as a whole country, right? Not necessarily just confined to states like California, but again, as a whole. We think about how that influences our identity, right? We're marked with a citizenship or a certain culture because of, the society we belong to, but also how our everyday lives are dictated. When we think about politics, right, and this is going to be a large part of a discussion as well, politics is basically, a discussion about what people can and can't do, what people should or shouldn't do, what an individual like you or me is allowed to do or isn't allowed to do, right? It's about agency, right? So in one way, we know we have rules, we obey them, sometimes they make sense and sometimes they don't, right? In more abstract ways, we are, our relationship to our government can be abstract, right? For instance, in our country, in the United States, there's, publicly subsidized free education for everyone, right? So right there, you are, forced, mandated by law to go to school, right? If you have children, you have to send them to school. It's mandated, right? You can get in trouble if you don't. And inside that, institution of education, you'll learn pre-prescribed. Not only are you going to learn, your ABCs, your 1-2-3s, but also ideology, right? So we can ask questions about who decides what we learn, how we learn it, when we learn it, or even which school you attend, right? So anyway, this is going to be our discussion. Now, the first part we're going to kind of break down is, we're going to start to understand how power and authority works, right? Power, is our ability, the ability of individuals or groups to make their own interests or concerns count, even when others resist, right? So power is extremely important, right? When we think about governments, and we'll get some of this terminology down, government refers to the regular enactment of policies, decisions, and matters of the state on the part of officials within a political apparatus. And again, we'll get this this definition out of the way. Politics, right? Means by where power is used to affect the scope and context of government activities. So within that, we have power. Individuals have power, the state has power, organizations have power, right? If anything, politics is about using power in strategic ways. Collectively, groups gather together and form parties. Here in the United States, we have two dominant parties, Democrat and Republican. You can ask yourself a question or feel free to call and write in and, kind of explain or define what it means to be part of one of those parties. Moving forward, right? We also surrender power, right? You listen to authority figures. Think about, law enforcement. Why do people pull over? On one side, it's coercion, right? If there is a police officer or a patrolman behind you, the lights are flashing as you drive down the road or walk down the street and they come up to you and say, stop. Most people will obey, right? You might not run away, you might not resist, one, because you may feel you haven't done anything wrong, you have nothing to fear. But the other is, even if you do fear, even if you don't want to stop, if it's an inconvenience at its most simplest, there are ways to coerce you. You know that you will be in trouble if you don't do this. The same thing with taxation, right? A lot of folks have an issue with it, right? But again, if you don't report taxes, if you don't claim taxes, if you try to cheat on it, you run the risk of, the government taking a penalty out on you, right? So anyway, there's power, right? So politically, people exercise power collectively. They form, allegiances or, and basically when we think about politics, that's all it is again, working collectively, establishing alliances in order to protect vested interests, right? Each and every one of us has a vested interest, something that we think is important, something that things in our life that we feel we must protect, right? And again, inside politics, there can be a disagreement on whether those things should be protected or not. Now, we've talked about power. Again, each and every one of us has power, but authority, not everyone has authority, right? When we think about the state, authority, we can understand it as this. Authority can be a government's legitimate use of power, right? And those subjects to a subject to a government's authority, a government's authority to consent to it, right? So we consent to power, right? Whether it's actively or inactively, right? Whether you say I consent or whether it's a passive function in society. Authority is, one of these things that we can experience, very intimately with our relationship to the state, or, again, abstractly, right? So when this concept of the state exists as a political apparatus, and its authority is what, forces us or allows us to recognize it or obey it, right? When you pay taxes, even those of you who aren't, generating income or are too young, still generate or still, indirectly pay taxes, right? Through consumption and things of that nature. But, authority is, extremely important in the world. It's basically, at its root, a discussion about legitimacy, right? What is the legitimate, right? Or legitimate uses of power. For instance, when we think about power, and Max Weber points this out early on, when we think about one way of using power, which is through violence, the state is the one organization, the one entity that has the legitimate use of power or violence, right? When we think about our state, our government, which ways do we see authority and how does it protect its authority or its sovereignty, right? You know, we can think about police departments or the military. It's through the use of force. So sometimes, you know, we have to wonder about it, and this is one way you can kind of think about it, you know. Oftentimes, in order to create peace, there has to be the threat of or the use of violence, right? At its most basic level, you know, you can think of peace officers who carry weapons, right? That threat of violence in itself must exist or exists, right? It's not necessarily, you know, philosophically a must, but exists in order to create peace. So, you know, for some, it's, you know, one of those things that, you know, might be a situation where, you know, you have to break a few eggs in order to make an omelet. But in other instances, you can look at it as a contradiction in itself, right? So, you know, we're going to deal with these things as we move forward. But again, you know, authority, underlying authority, there has to be power and a way to enforce it, right? You know, if we were in a class, and this is kind of to illustrate illegitimate uses of power, you know, or illegitimate uses of force, we can think about, you know, if we were in a traditional classroom and I took it upon myself to encourage or police behavior by striking people, hitting people, right? Would that be acceptable? Would that be a legitimate use of power? Would that be okay? You're probably thinking, no, it wouldn't, right? But think about why. Is it because I don't need to strike someone in order for them to listen? Or it's beyond the realm of my authority? Or maybe violence is never an answer. Maybe there's never a right situation to use violence. You know, within that discourse, and this is kind of the point, there's a, you know, that there's a discourse present. There's arguments. And again, you know, these arguments we can, you know, kind of analyze whether it's at a very basic, you know, intimate level, you know, in our own lives and how we understand authority and how it plays a role in our lives, or at a grander scale, right? When we have a discussion about war making or whether, you know, the state should, you know, go to war in certain, you know, situations, right? So we'll have more of this discussion as we move on. Now, we want to also discuss about this concept of the state, right? Now, this is another definition. A state exists where there is, again, a political apparatus of government ruling over a given territory. Authority is backed by a legal system and a capacity to use military force. Now, historically, again, authority has been linked to physical space. Now, one of these concepts, I don't know if we'll have time to discuss it, is some of these virtual spaces. You know, this is one way the world is changing. How do you define virtual space? Or who has authority inside the internet? Is it, you know, decided by where the servers are or what the URL is? Or is it the people who, you know, does it, you know, is it confined to where the people are around the world who are creating this content or interacting, right? This is a question for much later. But again, the state is, again, the political apparatus tied to a physical territory. So if you're in the United States or if you're in California or in Los Angeles, you must abide by the rule of law that has been established there. Rules, policies, regulations. So, you know, one way to kind of illustrate this is, you know, think about speed limits, right? Some of you might, you know, be allowed to drive very fast on the open highway. There are some places here, you know, in the United States where there is no speed limit, but for the most part, right, most of us are subjected to the 65 mile per hour speed limit. It's a national speed limit, right? Before it was 55, right, on the open highway or freeway. You know, if you're a car enthusiast, you might know about the German Autobahn, where there is no set limit as far as the number, right? It's mostly associated with safety. As long as it's safe to drive that velocity, for the most part, there are many places where you can't unless posted, right? Right there, you know, there are two ways of seeing, you know, how fast people should go. And again, there's politics around that. On one side, it's about safety and gas consumption. On the other is, you know, limiting a person's freedom, right? These are discussions that we can have and we can think about, right? Because again, politics is you know, about what you can and can't do, and the state, how it, you know, how the state defines it or how it's defined collectively, right? Because you yourself might want to do something, but you're regulated by the state. You know, many of you might still be minors, right? You know, this whole idea of delinquency is about defining certain behavior as regulated or prohibited depending on age. Now, we all, you know, have been educated for the most part, I'm assuming we've been educated about the ills or the dangers of smoking, right? You know, if you choose to smoke and you're under the age of 18, that's prohibited. There's a rule. But again, who decided this rule and why is 18 the magic number? Or even drinking alcohol, right? You know, something that has been brought up for a long time, and some states are increasing, or at least one state, I don't remember the state in particular, but is considering or has increased the legal age for alcohol consumption as a, you know, and it's backing it by, public health reasons or safety reasons, right? Why is 21 for the most part the legal age in order to drink, right? Or why, you know, is the legal age at 18, you know? These are things that we have to kind of consider because elsewhere in the world, it might not be the same. You know, in England, you know, you're an adult at 16 and you can drink legally at 18, right? So there's 2 years difference. So anyway, we'll keep, you know, kind of thinking about these things. Now, what I want to share with you next is a video on on the history and the decline of political power. And it's a little dense, but again, political power is something that we have to kind of always keep in mind as we go through this discussion. And within academia, there's a lot of thought that it's being exercised on the future of the state, whether, you know, 100 years down the line, we will understand the nation state the same way we do today, right? In an ever-increasing globalized world, the power of states, including the United States, is waning, and different kind of relationships are emerging. So, you know, it's something that we, again, have to keep in mind. Or, you know, in a world that's, continually being defined by, you know, small groups or ethnic groups or culture, right? You know, this is going back to that argument by, Huntington, the clash of civilizations. You know, is that what we're heading towards? It's all, no longer about states, but about how people understand their culture and, you know, and that within, you know, the discourse, right? You know, into that, you know, we can lead into terrorism, something that hopefully we'll have time to discuss today. But without further delay, let's watch a little bit about history and the decline of political power, and then we'll be back.
Changing nature of power and how it's wielded. Ray Suarez has our book conversation.
In the 21st century, is the power that comes with running things, governments, armies, religions, all that it used to be? In The End of Power, Moises Naim of the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace argues that power, as we've understood it for a long time, is both harder to use and to keep. He joins me now. Moises, governments are bigger than they've ever been, armies more powerful and able to project power more than they've ever been, banks also big enough to take down whole continents, much less countries. How could power be harder to use?
In each of those examples, you have situations where that shows that size no longer matters as much. Think about the Taliban and the army. They are facing the coalition army of some of the most modern, sophisticated military ever assembled. Well, they're not winning, but they're denying victory to this very large coalition. Think about the large companies that you mentioned, especially in the financial sector. Of course, they now concentrate a lot of assets, but many of them are under attack. Many of them have been, some of the CEOs have been fired. All of them are under a regulatory attack that is going to constrain even more what they can do. So for each one of the examples, and even the governments, think about the big governments that of course, they're larger, but they're also more constrained. They have a long list of actors. They are like Gullivers, just tied down by Lilliputians.
So is it really that power is not as easy to keep and to use, or that it's distributed in more places and more people have it?
Of course, and it's both. And the end result is that it's easier to acquire, but as you said in the introduction, much harder to use and more fleeting.
We have seen the spectacle of a new pope being elected, and here's an institution that's 2,000 years old that hundreds of millions of people have a vital interest in, is the Pope a less powerful person than he would have been in the 19th century?
Think about the process of selecting this new Pope, and think about the coalitions that were forming, how different issues, different regions, different factors played into the selection of this new Pope. And think about how in places like Africa, like Latin America, the Vatican is losing market share, so to speak. There are more and more contenders and rivals and new types of religions and Pentecostalists and all kind of Protestant churches. Protestantism is growing. Brazil, in 1990, the census said that 90% of Brazilians called themselves Catholics. Now, 65%. In many countries in Latin America now, Catholicism is not the main religion.
You've mentioned that power is more attenuated, and in the book you describe the ways that there are more checks and balances at play, that even people we perceive as being very powerful find it more difficult to use that power. Has that created a more stable and in some ways safer world?
Well, there's a lot to welcome, a lot to celebrate in this trend where autocrats and monopolists and people that concentrate a lot of power have a harder time retaining. They're less secure in their power. So there's a lot of good things happening there, but there is also a downside, especially in governments, in democracies that are surrounded by constraints. What political scientist Frank Fukuyama calls vitocracies. A lot of democracies have become vitocracies, meaning that they are full of small centers of power. Each one has a little bit of power to stop and block and veto the initiatives of others, but no one has enough power to push through an agenda, a policy, a decision. Look at the requester in the United States and how difficult it has become to just make some fundamental decisions about how to tax and spend. Look around the world and the kinds of coalitions, very strange political coalitions need to be assembled that are unstable, that are fractured, that are hard to keep together, and have a hard time making decisions without diluting them, without postponing them, and without really giving them the content that is needed to really make a dent on the problems they're trying to address.
Sure, as you say, the power of no is really quite potent in the 21st century, but can we flip that and maybe think of it as a more democratic ideal, the idea that the average person in the world is experiencing new power by being able to refuse to listen to the people that they used to listen to, or be understood to have to listen to?
There's no doubt that the trends have empowered individuals, have given individuals more choice, more opportunity, more options. And they're exercising that. There's no doubt about that. But there is another side to it in which no one decides, in which everyone is empowered, everyone has a little bit of power, but there is no one who organizes the game. There's no one that provides direction. There's no one that makes the decisions, the collective decisions that we all need to live in society.
So are we on our way? I mean, if that is not a very good recipe for running a world, are we on our way to a more collaborative planet? Will stakeholders decide that, yes, there is some power in no, but maybe there's a little bit more power in working together?
I hope so. I hope so. I think a lot of democracies are choking in checks and balances. There are too many constraints that don't let governments govern. And I'm not suggesting that they have to become more autocratic or that we have to give a blank check to a government. They need to be constrained and scrutinized, and accountability is a very important facet of democracy. But they need to have some power to run things. And that is where we need to move towards. And that scrutinizing and understanding what are the checks and balances that are now in place that are counterproductive is a very important exercise.
I want to continue our conversation online, but Moises Naim, thanks for joining us.
Thank you, Ray.
Welcome back. Okay, so right there we're introducing these ideas of power, politics, and individual choice. And again, if you want to comment, share your reflections, or have something to contribute, feel free and call 800-339-1193. We welcome your call. All opinions are good and valid. Or you can write in at askdhtv@gmail.com. Now, Katie has written in. She took this opportunity. She writes, I think we tend to view rules and regulations in a negative way. most people in place, most are in place to establish order, social order, something that we learn in class, right? I also think that rules are made after there are problems. I do not see all rules as negative, and rightly so. You know, there are some rules that protect us and, you know, negotiate life for us. And another, you know, very valid point Katie brings up, our rules, or the rules that we tend to see grab our attention, merely reactionary when we see, you know, some social ill or enough folks are hurt by it. You know, when we think about social problems and, you know, some of the solutions, or when we believe there should be solutions, again, that's linked to vested interest, right? It's when people feel that some part of their life, life is threatened, you know, that we tend to take action. But at the same time, if we don't feel threatened by it, or it's not really in our circle of our interests, you know, in that field, we might not see the need to, right? And, you know, in a third case, you know, someone else's opportunity might be our, you know, a potential constraint. So when we think about privilege, right, and the changing of rules, right, freedom for some might mean, you know, less freedom for others, right? Things to kind of think about, or more opportunity, right? So again, things to kind of think about, you know, again, this reactionary side that society has. But going back to this video, right, you know, how much should governments govern, right? When rules are put into place, you know, they are influencing the amount of agency people have, what people can and can't do, choices and opportunities, constraints, and, you know, how much authority is too much? That's a question that you might want to kind of think about. And again, you know, this idea of coalitions and alliances being formed to protect vested interests, and this idea that there has to be a balance within government. You know, you can't have it too relaxed, you know, for some, or too oppressive. But at the same time, you know, governments must govern. Or at least, you know, if that's what we want within a society. You know, this is going back to this idea of the social contract. You know, how much government should we have? Or, you know, how much of society should be promoted? Or, you know, maybe, you know, you can go, you know, along the line of, you know, Margaret Thatcher, there is no society, right? So things to kind of think about, right? So let's talk about the characteristics of the state, right? And as we discuss this, you know, think about how the state or the government influences your life, like where you live, how you live, what opportunities you have because of it or in spite of it, how we understand our relationship to it, right? And how it's shaping, you know, your choices, your ability, your agency, your freedom. So anyway, going forward, let's discuss this idea of sovereignty, right? And again, these are the characteristics of a state. Sovereignty, that a government possesses over, that a government possesses authority over an area with clear-cut boundaries within which it is a supreme authority. So supreme authority within a territory, right? You know, a piece of land, or, you know, again, we're, you know, more and more with technology, we're dealing with these abstract notions of, you know, copyrights and the internet. But let's keep it simple, right? We all live in cities, counties, states, nations, right? When we look at a map, we can outline it and say, okay, these rules are to be, to govern people within this given territory, right? Like, for instance, you know, the United States has very clear rules. Your county that you live in has rules and policies. What's legal in one county might not be legal in another. What's legal in one state might not be legal in another. Or what's legal in one country might not be legal in another, for instance, right? We can take an issue like gambling or something like gambling. In some states, it's allowed, right? Like, for example, as a whole, California regulates its gambling. For the most part, most counties, most cities don't allow gambling or some types of gambling. But if you go over to Nevada, a lot of types of gambling are allowed. People, you know, whole industries are, you know, created and maintained with this allure of, you know, recreational gaming, right? But think about it, right? You know, You know, it's just a line on a map, right? Or at least it's an abstract line, right? You can pass from one state to another, right? In counties, you know, they, you know, counties have different, you know, laws and ordinances. You know, some say you might be able to have certain kinds of animals. Some say you might not be able to. Some require you to pay certain taxes. Some don't, right? Again, that's all related to who has sovereignty over that piece of land or that territory. Now, let's think about this in a more macro kind of way, to kind of illustrate it the same way. The United States has sovereignty. There's no other country that says, oh, you can't do this or you can't do that inside the United States. Like, for instance, rules inside Canada or Mexico, you know, Canadian rules don't apply in the United States, nor do rules from Mexico, right? You know, the rules that matter are the rules that have been established by the political authority inside the United States, or the United States government, or, you know, the different states, counties, etc. So when you go to court, or as you go through your daily life, you have to abide by these rules. So that's sovereignty, right? It's not questioned. There's no other entity questioning it, right? When we think about failed states, though, right? You know, like Somalia, Sudan, we see another phenomenon happening. This is something that the United States doesn't suffer from, right? But there is no other group, there is no other entity inside the United States that has, or that challenges, or at least has been recognized to challenge, or has that challenges the American sovereignty inside, you know, inside our borders. In other words, there's no second government or a group that, you know, challenges the government's authority. In failed states, there are, you know, it might be, in a situation like a civil war, or in places where the government's very weak, there are smaller groups or individuals with the ability to exercise mass violence that often gain power. So when individuals are taxed, right, one way you can see, you know, sovereignty at work is how people get taxed. Like, for instance, you know, we pay our income tax to the federal government, but in a failed state, people might not recognize the official government, right? They might pay for protection or pay kickbacks to whomever has a, you know, weapon in their face, right? Like, for instance, here, you know, one way we see political authority at work is with police departments, right? You know, there's no secondary group, or the use of violence is a legitimate, you know, outside of that. We feel protected by the state. That's one of the relationships we might have with it. We might feel that we're protected, right? That we don't have to worry about our stuff being stolen, or, you know, and allows us to do other things. You know, Rousseau writes about this, right? You know, in other states, we have to worry about it. Or you might have two entities that, you know, are competing for sovereignty within an area, right? You know, this is a worry inside of Mexico, you know, whether it might be, you know, down the line of failed state, or certain areas have characteristics that you find in failed states where, you know, individuals, because of clandestine economies, have more power than the actual state does within certain areas, whether it's because of economic power or physical power, you know, through the use of violence. When we think about sovereignty, you know, along with that, we can also have this discussion of citizenship, right? So we can also think about what it means to be a citizen. So citizens have common rights and duties, and know themselves to be a part or members of a national community, right? We all, for the most part, can adopt this label as American, right? And again, when we think about legitimacy, what makes you American, doesn't make you American, or we can use this hierarchical order to think about it, who's more American than the other. But again, at its most basic, you know, it's a characteristic, right? We can think about these characteristics, what it means to be a citizen, right? Is it just waving a flag on the 4th of July, or is it, an indomitable set of rights that we have, or privileges, right? So when we often think about, or how one thing we can point to is this idea of nationalism. Nationalism is a set of symbols and beliefs providing a sense of being a part of of a single political community, right? So this political community, you know, here in the United States, we learn it, right? It's part of our culture. It's part of our, you know, it's inside of our institution of education, right? When you learn about the flag or what the flag represents, you learn about the history, a shared history, right, of the United States, shared values that are associated with it. You know, some of it is learned through myths, like, you know, I can, you know, ask you all or some of you, and this is, you know, I'm only going to ask a question, I'm not going to answer it in order to stimulate this kind of thought, but, you know, I might ask you all, you know, what, you know, when George Washington chopped down the proverbial cherry tree, what kind of values, moralities were we being taught, right? When we look back at some of the leaders, especially presidents, what kind of values are we taught about them? What, you know, and then we might look at this alternative history or suppressed history and learn much more, right? You know, when we think about the characteristics that make us American, right? Again, you know, it's linked to how we perceive not only our government, but our way of life here in the United States, a value system, right? That we've all learned, you know, have a relationship with and identify with in one way or the other, right? So something like freedom is very important, right? So when we think about nationalism, you know, that's one part of it. But inside of that, you can also have local nationalisms, right? This is regional displays of nationalism, often in opposition to the larger political state. You see this in Canada with French, you know, the French Canadian part. You know, even though, you know, Canada is a sovereign state, you might see celebrations of Bastille Day, right? In the United States, you might see similar occurrences. It's not to say that, you know, it's necessarily bad or good, but, you know, this does, this does exist, right? Where individuals might celebrate an Independence Day, you know, within a sovereign nation, you know, like, either, you know, some people might celebrate Bastille Day, Mexican Independence, etc. But again, you know, this is going back to our, you know, to remind you a little bit about what we've, you know, discussed before. You know, some of it might be only symbolic or situational. Like this, you know, celebrating Bastille Day in Canada or in the United States might merely be symbolic and a nod towards, a person's heritage. But you know, again, that's another discussion. You know, what qualifies a person, you know, as, you know, as their ethnicity, and what's legitimate and what's illegitimate about it. So anyway, we're going to start our next, you know, our next part of our discussion is going to be on citizen rights or civil rights. Again, as citizens, we are granted certain rights. We have this concept of our rights. You know, in school, we learn about, you know, these overarching rights, like the Bill of Rights. But then again, we do have rights and privileges and protections under the law, some of which are more abstract and that you need legal advice to understand, and others that are exalted, again, like the Bill of Rights. So that, again, supersede everything. So what we're going to take a look now at is a short video on the civil rights movement in 1964. Again, here you can bring in some of the stuff that you learned before, that you, how you understand it, and kind of bring it into this discussion of what the state is and how it, you know, operates in our everyday life and has in its role historically. So let's watch this now, and then we'll be right back in about 3 minutes.
Batons, police dogs, and fire hoses. On July 2nd, 1964, the simple stroke of a pen proved more powerful in the fight for civil rights. On that day, President Lyndon B. Johnson signed into law landmark legislation protecting the basic rights of minorities. The Civil Rights Act of 1964 prohibited racial discrimination in employment and education, and outlawed racial segregation in all public places and most private businesses.
Its purpose is not to divide, but to end divisions. Divisions which have lasted all too long.
In the years prior to the Act's passage, the civil rights movement had been steadily gaining strength. A major catalyst was the 1954 Supreme Court decision, Brown versus Board of Education, in which separate but equal was declared unconstitutional. Another turning point in the movement was the arrest of Rosa Parks and the Montgomery, Alabama bus boycott. Then there were the sit-ins at segregated lunch counters across the South. But with each victory came violence. By the time President John F. Kennedy introduced his civil rights bill in June of 1963, racial tensions were at the breaking point.
If an American, because his skin is dark, cannot eat lunch in a restaurant open to the public, if he cannot send his children to the best public school available, if he cannot vote for the public officials who represent him, if, in short, he cannot enjoy the full and free life which all of us want, then who among us would be content to have the color of his skin changed and stand in his place?
JFK's assassination that November put the pressure of its passage squarely on his successor's shoulders. President Johnson fervently took up the cause. Southern Democrats in the Senate tried to talk the bill to death, but Johnson's powers of persuasion finally won out. The bill narrowly passed and became law on July 2, 1964. It marked the end of a Herculean struggle by civil rights advocates and the beginning of a long road toward reconciliation.
Welcome back. Okay, so there we watch a snapshot of the civil rights movement in in particular in 1964. Again, if you want to comment, write in. Feel free to call us at 800-339-1193 or write us at askdhtv@gmail.com. So some of the questions that you can ask. Okay, first, one of the first images we see is the state's use of violence, right? We see firemen, police officers, state law enforcement using, water, dogs, physical brutality against its citizens, right? So, right there, there was this, there's this discussion we can have, right? Today we kind of see it as, racist individuals in the South who are misguided by, tradition and, hate. But at the time, right, some felt that this was a legitimate use of violence and others, illegitimate, right? But again, this is politics at action. People exercising their right on one side to assemble, protest, and bring attention to the inequalities. Again, this happened frequently in the civil rights movement, but the other side, the state, protecting the vested interests of those in power, right? So, what it actually did is, especially with the Civil Rights Act of 1964, what it did, it forced the hand of the federal government to intervene in the way states were running or protecting or observing the rights of individuals, right? The other part is, again, this is highlighted with, Brown versus the Board of Education. There we see policy, right? Policy that said separate facilities were legal and provided equal, resources, et cetera, separate but equal. And, this was struck down. And now, individuals had to be given the same opportunities in education and other institutions inside society. But again, for a long time, this was the law, right? It was enforced by the state and protected by the state. So when we think about political rights or social rights, or civil rights, right? There's a discourse there, right? And through action, whether inside the system by reforming the system or historically through, different revolutions, right? You know, there's a political process at work. One saying that certain individuals shouldn't have certain rights or should be provided rights. And even with the inception of the nation state, this idea that people could govern themselves, right? Later on, we'll kind of talk about democracy and such. You know, was a revolutionary idea. You know, it displaced this idea of monarchies, or, you know, that suggested that certain individuals, because of, you know, lineage, had the right, the birthright to rule over people. Now, for the most part, you know, most of the world, you know, this has, you know, many of these, you know, kind of regimes and states have been overthrown, right? And now individuals have some say in choosing which leaders will represent their interests. You know, people in the United States, you know, have more power than, you know, our predecessors did in, you know, not only ancient history, but part of modern history. So things to kind of think about, right? So we talked about, we're going to talk about political rights, the right to participate in elections and to run for office. You know, African Americans and women, you know, had the right to vote prior to the Civil Rights Movement. But what was won during the Civil Rights Movement was equality, right? Before then, there were a lot of legal obstacles that prevented individuals from voting, right? Some of which were, you know, tests or poll taxes that some folks couldn't afford, you know, especially in the South, you know, with a predominant number of the African American population being, you know, socially, I mean, economically deprived, you know, the poll taxes were a burden on them and kept many away from, you know, the ballot box. Other rules such as, poll exams prevented individuals from, participating in the political process because, you know, some were illiterate or, you know, the way the tests were constructed, you know, it was a very discriminatory test and, you know, was on information that was very, antiquated or very specific, things that, you know, the common person wouldn't know about. Now, Madeline writes in, we see a lot of celebration of different heritages throughout our country. California is especially diverse as we celebrate everything from Cinco de Mayo to Chinese New Year. The holiday brings us together somehow in a sense of everyone can be a part of something. They also help make every state more individual. And this is true. You know, the country has always been shaped by the people that, you know, come to inhabit it. You know, again, we talked about this with, slightly with culture, you know, whether it's a process of multiculturalism or assimilation, you know, American culture is made up of a great many cultures, right? Over time, you know, they become incorporated, you know, ritualized, institutionalized, and eventually, you know, become part of the fabric that, you know, make up our, you know, sense of who we are. You know, for instance, you know, something we talked about, brought up before is that, you know, we can take a pastime like baseball and see how different cultures have influenced it. For example, you know, the food we eat there, you might see eat hot dogs, you know, that's kind of German influence. Or here in Los Angeles, you know, you see a fusion of different holidays, different cuisines, different cultures, different, you know, even music, right? You see influences from all over the world, right? So again, you know, this is kind of the question with that we can, you know, kind of think about when we think about globalization, is that, you know, are we becoming more different or more the same, or, you know, where is culture going to lead us? Because at the other part, you know, people see this as a threat, right? You know, all this multiculturalism, you know, can mean that some people might see it as a changing, you know, of reality as they know it, and it can be a threat. So, you know, when, you know, in order to understand like hate and racism and things like that, we also have to understand how people, and again, this is not trying to justify it, but, you know, how people can view others as a threat or the changing culture as a threat, right? But I mean, this is, you know, these are processes that go on. Moving on with our discussion of rights, we also have social rights, right? This is the right of individuals to enjoy certain minimal level of economic welfare and security, right? The government plays a role in it. For example, there are minimum wages, right? You know, standards of living that are used to, figure out how much people need to live, what level of, what type of life a person is minimally required to have before they're considered poor. And, you know, when we think about the welfare state or the social safety net, right, this is a government organizing to provide material benefit for those who are unable to reach that or support themselves adequately through paid employment. So, for instance, we can think about welfare or government assistance in different ways. You know, traditional welfare, for individuals who are, considered poor or aren't making enough with the incomes they receive. But, oftentimes that becomes demonized because people who are, poor don't have a lot of political power or have been disenfranchised from the system itself. Other things like unemployment, right, is something that is also, regulated by the government and is part of that social safety net, right? That often doesn't come under critique because of the, because it kind of spans through different class levels. You know, in 2008, when the economy collapsed, a lot of folks came to understand the importance of a social safety net, right? Enrollments in things like public, SNAP or welfare increased. The gray portion of our population, those who are, older Americans, they understand or have some, might have some, have more of an interest in, might have more of an interest in this social safety net because they might, rely on Social Security and Medicaid, right? Again, those are paid for through, tax dollars. It's paid for collectively, but, we don't even have to go that far and, to kind of think about, social rights. When we think about the government, it's also, here in the United States, the roads that we drive on, the schools that we attend, this university is subsidized by the taxpayers in California and some, and it also receives some federal funding, right? This is a public benefit, something that, again, something like education feeds into the economy directly, right? And it maintains, a certain, level of economic power within the United States. When we discuss, education later on, we'll kind of explore this again, but we, this is something we talked about when we talked about a class here in the United States. So social rights. So keeping in this theme with, again, the civil rights movement and whatnot, what I want to share with you next is a short video on Hector Garcia and the American GI Forum. We'll talk about this a little, but again, this is another part of the civil rights movement, people exercising their collective power and their collective interests in order to bring about change. And again, this took place in the 60s. You'll see some faces again, like Lyndon Johnson, who was integral in, changing some policy to benefit minorities. So without further delay, let's watch this video and then we'll be right back.
Garcia, decorated war veteran, humanitarian, and the first Mexican-American civil rights activist. After heroic service in World War II, getting married, and starting a family in his home state of Texas, Hector Garcia noticed his fellow Mexican-Americans, including veterans, were still subjected to the systematic discrimination he had grown up with, denied the same American freedoms they had fought for during the war. Growing up in Texas, Garcia had faced discrimination throughout his life. As a little boy whose family started over in poverty after fleeing the Mexican Revolution. As a top medical student denied a required residency. As a humanitarian healer
offering free treatment to impoverished patients at his medical practice in South Texas. To help his fellow soldiers, Garcia founded the American GI Forum, a civil rights organization assisting Mexican-American veterans and their families to vote, go to school, and enter public places they were formerly forbidden. The GI Forum made history in 1949 when fallen soldier Felix Longoria was denied a proper burial by his Texas hometown because he was Mexican-American. A powerful letter written by Dr. Garcia was answered the next day by war veteran and new Texas Senator Lyndon Johnson. Private Longoria was soon given a military burial at Arlington National Cemetery. He is the first Hispanic American soldier to be buried there. This event propelled Dr. Garcia into the national civil rights movement, and his pioneering efforts for social reform were recognized by presidential appointments and special delegations. In 1984, he received the Presidential Medal of Freedom, America's highest civilian honor. He was the first Mexican-American to receive it. Dr. Héctor Garcia's indomitable force and powerful voice were still.
Welcome back. So there we see, you know, the some of the history of the American GI Forum. Again, this is a, when we look at it, we see this is an example of collective action, right? Through voter drives, education of the public, certain policies that were discriminatory against, again, you know, when it initially began, it was mostly Mexican-American veterans of World War II who felt, you know, this relative deprivation because, again, here they were, you know, sent off to Europe and Japan and elsewhere to protect, the nation, right? But when they, and again, this is the same story for other, minorities, African Americans, Japanese Americans, American Indians, were sent off to, protect, save, and, fight back, the Axis countries, here we see individuals, give up part of their lives, give up their lives in order to protect, the interests of the United States. But when they come back home, weren't given the same, opportunities or protections under the law. So again, this, sentiment of relative deprivation, right? Here they are defending, a nation that doesn't treat them equally. Now, they felt that, something should be done, and so they took up action, right? Through collective action, whether it's creating a voting block, right? Through voter registration, so, certain candidates could be placed in positions of power to advocate for these communities, or through social movements that took to the streets to bring attention to these contradictions inside American society, right? So anyway, this is possible again, because of the democracy in place, right? So let's define democracy before we start discussing it, right? So it's a political system in which people, not monarchies or aristocracies, rule. So this concept of democracy is, again, a revolutionary idea for the most part, for a long time in human history. Aristocracies, monarchies were in place, right? If you weren't born into these families, your position, your station in life was predetermined, and you had very little rights or say. You were superseded by those who were more from a more divine lineage than common people were, right? But with the democracy, again, here in, if we take the United States, for example, and we'll talk about our country, here is that, we work under this assumption that we are all created equal, right? This is, again, a revolutionary idea because for most of human history, when we think about the state, people weren't created equal. There were classes, there were castes, individuals were, had certain birthrights. But again, here in the United States, we work under this principle. Now, in a participatory democracy, this is direct democracy where decisions are made by a community by the made communal by those affected by them is a different type of democracy. We don't necessarily, you know, have that. I think the book, you know, says that we do have a participatory democracy. You know, it's up to debate. You know, what I would say is we have, you know, again, this is a republic. We choose our representatives and they represent our interests. Now, this is problematic because, again, you know, when officials are elected, they're serving many different interests, right? And when we think about, you know, the amount of money in our inside our political system, right? This question gets brought up every political cycle. You know, are votes bought, or you know, do we still have, you know, individual power? You know, individuals' rights to elect their, you know, officials here in the United States. Because again, you know, the masses can be swayed. You know, politics is about information, and whoever can control more of the discourse, you know, often has a huge advantage, right? So anyway, you know, we'll keep moving forward. Some other systems, you know, monarchies, constitutional monarchies, you know, our formal power of a monarchy is severely restricted. You see this in, you know, in the United Kingdom. Real governing power is elected, real power rests in elected representatives of people. Liberal democracy, this is what we have in the United States. Voters choose between two or more parties in which the mass of the adult population has a right to vote. So here in the United States, we have a liberal democracy, and it, for the most part, has spread across the world, right? In large part due to the promotion of the system by the, you know, by intellectuals in the, you know, American state. So anyway, the spread of the liberal democracy, right? Prior to the 1980s, you had two kinds of dominant ways of, you know, ruling people. You had the liberal democracy, which we enjoy in the West, and communism, which was a system of a single party rule still practiced in at least China, Cuba, and North Korea, even though the type of communism at work in China is changing. But again, you know, this is a system of one party rule, may or may not, usually doesn't have electoral process, but it's how, again, communism, you know, is not only a political system, but a system in which, governs the economy. You know, a liberal democracy governs an economy differently, right? And again, you know, that's one of the aspects that we can think about when we think about the state, right? Is how the economy is governed, right? Somewhere in China, it's state controlled for the most part, right? There is free enterprise in some forms there, but it's heavily regulated by the government. So, you know, one of the arguments is that individuals don't have really a right to, exercise their will like they want to inside the economy. Here in the United States, our economies are regulated, but not to the same extent. Right. Some ways our economies are regulated here. You know, for instance, if you want to start a business, you have to abide by government policy. Right. You have to have meet certain criteria before you're granted a business license, or before you're allowed to enter a certain business, you have to meet other criteria. Right. Licensing is something that, you know, can be constructed as a way to keep competition out or to protect the public. Right. Either way, you know, it can keep people out because of, the costs associated with it. Right. So when we think about the free market, we truly don't have a real free market. Right. We have a free market market that's regulated by, you know, some government intervention. That's something to keep in mind. You know, and one part is to, well, at least a lot of it's to protect the public interest. Right. To regulate not only taxation, but, you know, the exchanges that individuals will make, you know, either for money or goods. But moving forward, right, one of the things that we want to spend some time on and to reflect on is this idea of democracy rights and how they may be, challenged, right? Especially with in light of some of the new legislation within the last decade that, you know, threatens individuals' privacy and sovereignty, right? For instance, with the Patriot Act. But what we're gonna watch next is a short video on surveillance in the NSA. So one of the questions that we can kind of flirt with today is, you know, whether surveillance is something that we want as part of our daily life, right? The first thing with surveillance is that it's neutral, right? And by that I mean, you know, watching someone can either be for the benefit, can work for someone or against someone. When information is just taken, it's neutral. It's what people do with it after the fact. Like, for instance, if we, watch, you know, a group of people to make sure that they're safe, is that a positive way to surveil them, or is it, you know, encroaching on their individual rights? Because we all have a right to privacy. You know, most of us have windows in our home and we put up blinds and curtains in order to protect that privacy. Should the limitations of privacy just end when you walk out the doorstep, or should your digital rights be protected? Because again, you know, even though surveillance is neutral, it's what people do with it, right? You know, can it be used for nefarious deeds, or is it in, you know, a way of, you know, having Big Brother protect society? Again, you know, are we going to be complicit with this argument that if you aren't doing anything wrong, you have nothing to fear, or should we, you know, protect this right that we have, regardless of whether we're doing something right or wrong, right? It's the principle. It's the ethics of the matter. So actually, I kind of jumped ahead now that I look at it. So we actually won't watch that video right away, right? Let's watch it now, and then we'll be right back. And one of the last things we'll talk about is voter turnout. So sorry about that, team. If we're ready to go, we can start it. Let's watch some of it, and then we'll be right back.
President Obama has said the NSA's information gathering on Americans was strictly limited and tightly overseen by the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Court, or FISA Court. But today, the Washington Post reported the spy agency has overstepped its legal authority thousands of times each year since Congress expanded its powers in 2008. And the FISA Court's chief judge told the Post his court doesn't have the ability to independently verify if the spy agency is complying fully with privacy protection rules. The report was based on documents leaked by former NSA contractor Edward Snowden. Washington Post correspondent Carol Lenig worked on both stories and joins me now. And Carol, welcome.
Thank you, Margaret.
First of all, what sort of information has the NSA been collecting and storing on Americans that is beyond the scope of the law or the court rules?
The court's rules are very strict on several things, but the most important is not intruding on Americans' privacy when there's no reason to suspect that they have some link to terrorist organizations or are in communication with foreign powers. And the violations that are documented in this memorandum from the NSA, remember, we're only seeing a partial window. We're seeing what the NSA headquarters reported in a year's time, not what all the other NSA satellite offices offered, but that in those instances, they broke some of the privacy rules and they broke some other rules that have to do with foreign intelligence gathering. The most striking, probably, example that people are taken by is that there were a series of phone call records stored from the Washington, D.C. area code, zip code, forgive me, area code 202. And this was a glitch. Essentially, it was because a switch misread 202 for 20, which is the country code for Egypt. We are allowed to collect a lot of records about foreign communications, but when you start collecting a lot of Washington, D.C. phone records, it's another story.
Now, had these violations been reported to the court, as I gather they're required to?
What's unclear from the document, because it's really an NSA internal audit is how many of these were reported to the court. A portion of them should have been that have to do with FISA authorities when you're looking into Americans' records. And we honestly don't have the rest of the chain to know what was reported. What we do know is that there are thousands of them, and that the Obama administration has assured us and the public before this came out that it happens infrequently, once in a while.
Now, equally startling was your companion piece, what the district court judge, Reggie Walton, said to you about the FISA court's authority when you asked him about this. Explain that a little more.
So he's the chief judge of the secret spy court, the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Court, that is supposed to be the linchpin for the checks and balances on our government spying programs. It takes it really seriously. It does everything in a classified secret SCIF, but it's a diligent, careful court. What he essentially said was, there are practical limitations on what we can do, and we must trust the government to report to us these violations, because we can't independently, with our resources, ferret that out.
And why can't the court ferret that out, verify the information independently?
Well, there are the obvious issues of resources. I mean, this is a court with a number of judges who all have plenty of busy dockets themselves. Reggie Walton has a very busy docket himself. And they have a staff of 5 lawyers.
For the whole court?
Yes. So those lawyers receive this information about the compliance violations. They review them. They elevate the most serious ones to a judge if it warrants it. And that's a very practical reason why it would be impossible to be policing and looking behind the government.
Welcome back. Okay, so we're going to cut it off a little early. If you want to learn more about it, quick search for news articles on NSA, Edward Snowden, and, you know, to kind of keep up to date, you'll be able to find online with the search engine of your choice. But again, if you feel like you have something to contribute, you want to comment or give your opinion, feel free to call us or write in at the number and email address just shown. Katie wrote in. Even though we live in a democratic society, those with money are many times more powerful. They can buy their way to power, and money talks. We see this in politics today. But again, one thing that we're going to explore next is how political, we're going to bring up this notion of political parties and voting, right? Because many of the, one of the things to keep in mind is that the money itself, can buy, votes, hypothetically, right? But again, these candidates or these people in power, our representatives, whether it's presidential or, all the way down to city board, rely on the votes of individuals, right? So this is not to say whether you should vote or not, but let's kind of think about the system first, right? So first, political parties. These are organizations of individuals with broadly similar aims oriented towards achieving legitimate control of the government through the electoral process. So the purpose of a political party is, again, to control the mechanisms or as much of the mechanisms as possible in order to push forward an agenda, right? Certain vested interests are collected. Here in the United States, we have 2 dominant parties, and if you look at them, sometimes they seem similar or sometimes they seem very different on different, subjects. Like, for instance, on, something like domestic surveillance, both parties have individuals who are very much, in defense of this government practice. Here in the state of California, Dianne Feinstein has been vocal in her support of, NSA spying. But again, if you want to read more about it, you should. When we think about politics and voting, we hypothetically or we've been indoctrinated with this idea that we have the power as individuals, as citizens of this nation, adult citizens, we have, the right to vote. But who votes in the United States, again, varies systematically by income, education, and class. More privileged older groups tend to vote more than less privileged younger groups. So what we want to do now is to kind of think about this process of voting and representation with another short video, right? Where we'll document voter turnout and its relatively low, the relatively low rates when compared to the rest of the world. Now, some of you might be able to vote, some of you have voted, some of you don't choose to vote. And each of those is kind of like a political decision because, again, you know, if, you know, this is our the way our government is structured, these are the rules that hypothetically we all have to play by. So participation or non-participation is the system in action. So we'll watch this video and then we'll be back and we'll kind of discuss this a little bit further and then wrap up our discussion for this chapter today. So let's watch that now and then we'll be right back.
Regardless of who's bankrolling America's political campaigns, the United States is seen as the hallmark of democracy by many people worldwide. But most Americans choose not to take advantage of their political rights. The United States has the second lowest voter turnout rate among the world's developed nations. In fact, only 57% of American citizens voted in the 2008 presidential election, and a mere 38% of Americans made it to the polls in the 2010 national elections. Those figures pale in comparison to the 89% of Belgians or the 85% of Swedes who voted in their last elections. So CCTV's Nina Donaghy set out to find out why so few Americans are engaged in the political process.
A summer's day in the nation's capital, enjoyed by ordinary American citizens who can name their vice president.
What's his name? Sorry, I'm drawing a blank.
And their home state senator.
I'm from Michigan. No, I can't.
They're up to date with political process.
Can you tell me what a super PAC is? Super PAC. PAC.
And know the membership of the U.S. Supreme Court.
Kennedy is his name, or Bow.
This is who will cast votes in November's presidential election. If Barack Obama and Mitt Romney can get their supporters engaged enough to go to the polls. Professor Jan Leakley is an expert in voter turnout.
Voters respond when they have choices between candidates. The bigger the difference in the candidates' policy positions, what they offer voters, the more likely they are to vote because it makes a difference. And so why, if candidates are similar, why should you spend your time and effort and energy showing up at the polls on election day?
In 2008, candidate Obama's soaring rhetoric captured the masses' imagination. But was it his message or his deft campaign strategy that really put him in office?
I'm here with you in that fight.
They have a very dedicated and focused campaign organization, both using social media as well as the good old-fashioned organizing groups in neighborhoods and especially urban areas where a lot of the vote comes from. And he'll resurrect those organizations. They know what's worked. They have a database.
However, Leakley says motivating on a grand scale is a defining skill of a successful politician.
Someone has to be willing to get out of bed and say it matters. And if you see a political leader who either has a vision or is speaking positively, whether that's Obama in this election or Reagan when he ran with his, you know, Morning in America, which is often attributed as motivating folks to show up at the election.
But what about the role of mass media? Did Obama learn from John F. Kennedy, who in the 1960s used the new medium of television to engage voters, in his use of the 21st century equivalent, social media?
You know, in the Kennedy era and beyond, there was one message, there was one major media source, and now we have a new type of media where there isn't a single presidential campaign. Campaigns, I don't know if slice and dice is the right term, but they identify, they have a message for each of their audiences. To get people to turn out, I think their social media will matter the most for youth who are far more likely to be online than older generations.
But one of the most dramatic episodes in U.S. voting history, where literally every single vote counted, was in 2000. The contested election that saw George W. Bush beat Al Gore in a painstaking manual vote recount.
Before 2000, no one ever questioned that when you dropped a paper ballot in a box that it wasn't counted. No one ever questioned if you were in a jurisdiction that had an electronic type of machine, that it could make a mistake. And it was a national stage, and that created a new audience.
How you guys doing?
Obama and Romney must first find their audience. Their next challenge, getting them to the polling booths on November 6th. Even here in the U.S. Capitol, that may not be so easy.
Maryland and a senator would be, oh, help me, come on, I know these guys.
Nina Donahue, CCTV.
Welcome back. Okay, so one thing that came up in that video is this concept of a super PAC, a political action committee. These are very large, not-for-profit organizations that serve to fund, different political campaigns, right? And again, every political campaign has vested interests, so corporations and individuals have interests that sometimes might be allied or might come, they might be at different ends of the spectrum as far as how policy should work and what, should be protected. Now, the issue with these committees is that, the fear or the concern or what's been, happening, depending on how you want to look at it, is, are they giving undue influence, in certain electoral processes? Like, for instance, what say should outside individuals, because a lot of this money comes from, from individuals who are, again, their identity might be protected, to a large extent being, funding these super PACs, and they circumvent certain, rules that, regulate, the contributions by individuals. And this money comes into certain districts or political races where, more advertisements can be bought for a particular candidate, or more importantly, these super PACs can, they themselves run ads that, may be, a little unethical, unethical or skew the truth in order to protect, the candidate that, is running against a candidate that is being vilified, through ads, right? That way, they can say, well, I don't support it, but, I would ask the voter to consider, make their own judgment. But at that, by doing that, they kind of let the super PAC do their dirty work, if you will, right? So there's a lot of issues kind of, tied to it. But again, when it comes down to it, it's still individuals making, making their voices heard. And there are some examples where huge amount of monies, going into a certain district really don't have as much of an influence as, as once considered, right? If a candidate's bad, no amount of money can really change that. But again, money and political campaigns and, very intelligent people behind these candidates, if the more people you have, the more resources you have, that's a very good deodorant for any candidate. So anyway, going back to this idea of voter turnout, the United States has some of the lowest numbers around the world. And again, it brings up brings in this question that, are we really being represented, right? Or is it our fault, right? If you don't go out to vote, because again, not everyone has that opportunity. Not everyone, again, is even registered to vote. So again, it's a problematic issue. Especially in our, in our system, folks who don't vote are vilified. Now, Julianne writes in, going back to this idea of, or this concept of surveillance, Julianne writes in, I've heard that Big Brother, and this is, another way of referring to the state and its way of surveilling, structure. Big Brother has an ability to turn on a video camera on a computer at any time. Is that really occurring? Now, the first thing I'd like to say about that is that, especially with technology, we all have to be careful. It doesn't necessarily mean that governments are exclusively have this power. Individuals can, you know, spy or surveil other individuals, whether it's, you know, your employer because they own the computer and they upload the software, or through a computer virus. Now, generally, I don't believe, you know, or most people don't believe that it's, you know, everyone's being spied on, just like as far as video cameras, but there are certain, you know, programs that look for keywords, or, you know, the other fear is that all internet traffic is being recorded all at once, right? But it's not looked at, right? There's a very big new NSA installation in New Mexico. This was the same accusation during the Bush presidency where, you know, traffic coming through the Pacific Corridor, I forget what the term is, was being copied, right? But the key is that, you know, what some experts believe is that there's either an effort to create some kind of mechanism that creates a way to do some predictive policing. You know, for example, a movie that, you know, came out a few years ago, like Minority Report, is about predictive policing, or in other words, trying to take this data, right, and either project, you know, who might be, you know, capable of either certain terrorist acts or certain crimes by looking at their spending patterns, who they associate with, what kind of, you know, even some of the fear is what kind of books people are reading. When the Patriot Act was first being discussed, you know, librarians across the country were opposed to libraries releasing, you know, the list of books people are reading, because in other words, you know, when you look at what people are watching, reading, you have some idea of what their interests are and how their world, or how they're socially constructing the world. But as far as, you know, actually, you know, the government watching people through cameras, I think in some cases of viruses have been used to, I guess, for to a certain extent, wiretap people who were classified as terrorists' computers, right? And I think one case I can remember, I don't remember the specifics, so my information might be skewed. But again, you know, some of that information is out there. A book that you might consider reading or watching some news reports on, one is called The Terror Factory. You know, and this is scrutinizing the FBI's role in the fight against domestic and international terrorism. But again, you know, all this, you know, should be concerning. But at the same time, you know, we also have to be aware that a lot of the information that we put on, the internet, we do it freely. You know, something like Facebook, you have to kind of keep in mind that you put information out there. You know, we're worried about spying, but a lot of the information we give up freely. But that's it for today. We'll be back next week, next Monday, with another broadcast. Make sure you keep up with the work. And that's it for us today. So long.